فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
باب منصوبات الأسماء. المنصوبات 15، وهي المفعول به والمصدر وظرف الزمان وظرف المكان والحال والتمييز والمستثنى واسم لا والمنادى والمفعول من أجله والمفعول معه وخبر كان وأخواتها واسمين وأخواتها. والتابع للمنصوب هو 4 أشياء: النعت والعطف والتوكيد والبدل.
The author rahimahullah, he now goes into a chapter called Al-Mansubat, Bab Al-Mansubat Al-Asma'. We spoke about, how many did we say that do rafa of the noun? 7. And now we're going to go into the 15 that make the noun mansub. 15. And each one we're going to mention it independently. The first of those is al-maf'ul bih, such as nadartu ibrahima, mazdar, which is fahimtu fahman, dharfu al-zamani and dharfu al-makan, sumtu yawm al-khamis is dharfu al-zaman, dharfu al-makan is jalastu 'inda al-ustadi, hal qadima yusuf rakiban, at-tamyiz taba muhammad nafsan ومنفسا. المستثنى أكرمت القوم إلا صالحا أما صالحا. اسم لا، لا غلام سفر في المنزل. المنادى يا رسول الله، تأديبا ضربت خادمي تأديبا، which is مفعول من أجله. المفعول معه حذر الأمير والجيش، خبر كان وأخواتها and اسم إن وأخواتها which we already took. كان محمد فاهما إن إبراهيم ناجح. Number 12 النعت رأيت محمدا العالم. العطف نظرت محمدا وأحمدا. توكيد أبصرت محمدا نفسه and رأيت خليلا أخاك. So we've already taken basically the last, we took the last 5. We took already, we spoke about kana wa khawatuha, we spoke about inna wa khawatuha, okay? We also spoke about the tawabi', the 4 tawabi', al-na'at wal-atf wal-tawqid al-badal. So we're really going to be dealing with the first 10, to be honest. So let's start with the first one here, al-maf'ul bih.
باب المفعول به وهو الاسم المنصوب الذي يقع به الفعل نحو قولك ضربت زيدا ركبت الفرس.
The author رحمه الله, he describes or he defines مفعول به with 3 things. مفعول به is when 3 things are present. First, it's اسم. فلا يكون فعلا ولا حرفا ولا جملة. So it's not going to be what? Okay? It's a ism. It's not a verb, it's not a harf, and it's not a jumla. And what I mean by jumla, we'll speak about it. Mutammimatul ajrumiyya. It is al-mansoob. Okay? Because of a fi'l. Okay? So it can't be marfu' and it can't be majrur. الذي يقع به الفعل, the action happens to it. This is an object. Those are the 3 points that the author mentions, which basically is the definition of the مفعول به. And it's منصوب, as we said. And the author then goes on to say the types. What are they? How many types?
والظاهر ما تقدم ذكره والمضمر قسمان متصل ومنفصل. فالمتصل 12 وهي ضربني وضربنا وضربك وضربك وضربكما وضربكم وضربكن وضربه وضربها وضربهما وضربهم وضربهن. والمنفصل 12 وهي إياي وإيانا وإياك وإياك وإياكما وإياكم وإياكنا وإياه وإياها وإياهما وإياهم وإياهن.
The author here says المفعول به ينقسم إلى قسمين. The مفعول به is categorized into two. The first one is مفعول به, which is ظاهر, apparent. And the second one is مفعول به, which is مضمر. We already spoke about what it means, المفعول به, which is ظاهر. We spoke about that. Okay? We said ظاهر means ما دل على مسماه بلا قرينة. It's anything that shows what it's showing you without any external agents or external force. Okay? We spoke about that. For example, ضربت زيدا وركبت الفرس. مضمر, on the other hand, is what the author mentions here. Okay? And he mentions that the مضمر is of two types. Okay? We already spoke about what مضمر means. ما دل على مسماه بقرينة. It shows you the thing that it's talking about with a قرينه, and the قرينه is either تكلم مخاطب or is غيبوبة, أما غيبة. صح, brothers. And the author رحمه الله categorized the ضمير إلى متصل ومنفصل. He categorized it into two. Okay, متصل is, what's the definition of متصل? متصل is ما لا يصلح الابتداء به أول الكلام. You can't start the speech with it. The متصل is anything, is a pronoun which you can't start the speech with. And it can't fall ولا يقع بعد إلا في الاختيار. According to choice, it can't happen after إلا as well. Okay? That's a محل النقاش amongst the grammarians. There's discussion going on regarding that. منفصل, on the other hand, ما يصلح الابتداء به. You can start the speech with it. Okay? You're allowed to start your speech with it. And it happens after إلا by choice. The author رحمه الله, he brings the types which are متصل, and he mentions 12 types. Okay, he mentions 12 types. ضربني وضربنا وضربك وضربك وضربكما وضربكم وضربكن وضربه وضربها وضربهما وضربهم وضربهن. The author mentions the متصل is 12. It is 12. Then the author رحمه الله goes into speaking about the مفعول, sorry, the ضمير, which is منفصل, the detached, and it's also 12. And it is anything that stems from the word إياي, and anything that stems from that, anything that comes from that, is منفصل. إياي وإيانا وإياك وإياك وإياكما وإياكم وإياكن وإياه وإياها وإياهما وإياهم وإياهن. All of those are what? They are all مفعول به. Wherever you see them, you know it's a مفعول به. It's a ضمير, which is منفصل. Okay? And that's why Allah says إياك نعبد وإياك. I don't think, this is my personal, Ashab Rizak can correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think in the Quran that the word إياكما has come ever. Yeah, has it? Yeah? Do you remember it? Yeah? What, has it come as جمع إياكم? Yeah, وإن كن ياكم, but it hasn't come تثنية. ياكما has never come. As a fact, Ibn Qayyim mentions, no, Astaghfirullah, he said that the word إياك has not come. No. This is what he said. Maybe there might be ياكما in the Quran. What he said was, sorry, is that the word إياك as a مفرد has only come in Surah Al-Fatiha. It's a long time ago when I read it. Zah, Abdul Zah. Yeah? The only time Mufrad is come, Iyaka, you only Allah. Yeah. You only Allah, Iyaka, Anta. I think it's Surah Al-Fatiha only. And it shows that that's the only time, that's the Surah that talks about Tawheed, the lesson of Tawheed. Anyways, Iyaka, Iyaki, Iyaki, Iyakuma, Iyakum, Iyakunna, Iyahu, Iyaha, Iyahuma, إياهم and إياهن, all of those are what? مفعول به. They are ضمير, which is basically منفصل, and it's 12 types. نعم.
باب المصدر. المصدر هو الاسم المنصوب المصدر هو الاسم الموصوف الذي يجيء ثابتا في تصريف الفعل نحو ضرب يضرب ضربا.
The author here, rahimahullah, he says that the masdar, according to the grammarians, is the third type of when the word is actually tossed and turned. For example, you say ضرب يضرب ضربا. So the word ضربا is a masdar that has come from a three stages. Okay, it went through a madi, mudari, and then it became a what? A masdar. Okay. So you bring the masdar from the mudari. Okay, that's what it comes after. Okay. And according to this masdar is known as mas'ul mutlaq. This masdar here is called mas'ul mutlaq, which is ضرب يضرب ضربا. This is what type of مفعول, what type of masdar is this? It's a mas'ul mutlaq. And the grammarians, they categorize it into three types. The first type is مؤكد لعامله. It emphasizes on the عامل. Okay, the عامل means the agent that's making it occur in the first place. It's actually emphasizing on it. And the عامل, my brothers and sisters, is the فعل. The fi'l muadhi or the mudari' that the sentence starts with is the عامل. Okay? So for example, you will say شربتُ, I drank. Okay? شُرْبًا. Okay? That's what you'll say, right? So here, the عامل is what? The عامل is شربتُ, I drank. You can say شُرْبًا or شَرْبًا. They're both the same. Are you with me, brothers? But شُرْبًا here is what? It's basically, what type is it called? مؤكد لعامل. You're emphasizing your drinking. You're saying, I drank, I drink. صح? The second is called مبين لنوعه. You're basically clarifying its type. Okay? For example, you will say, فهمت. I understood. فهم الأستاذ. The understanding of the teacher. So you clarify what type of understanding you understood. This is called مبين لنوعه. The third one is called مبين لعدده. You're basically clarifying and you're explaining the adad, the amount. So you'll say, سألتُ, I asked. سؤاليني, two questions. Okay? I asked two questions. Now. So I repeat the third one?
Yeah.
The third one is basically مبين لعدده. You are basically clarifying its amount. You're clarifying its amount. So you say, سألت, I asked, سؤاليني, two questions. So you're clarifying how many questions that you asked. Now.
وهو قسمان لفظي ومعنوي. فإن وافق لفظه اللفظ فعله فهو لفظي نحو قتله قتلته قتلا. وإن وافق معنى فعله دون لفظه فهو معنوي. نحو جلست قعودا وقمت وقوفا وما أشبه ذلك.
The author here, the masdar, which is called a maf'ul mutlaq, is two types. Okay, brothers. The masdar, which is referred to as maf'ul mutlaq, is two types. Qism, which is lafzi, a type which is wording based. قتلته قتلا. Okay, which the author brought, I killed him, a killing. Okay, or ma'anawi. Or, so the word that you took it, why is it lafzi? It's because you're using the same root word. Okay, the same, the words are basically the same. The second type is ma'anawi. Okay, brothers, the wordings are not the same, but the meaning are the same. For example, jalastu qu'udan. Jalas, julus and qu'ud is basically the same meaning. What's the difference? Does anyone know the difference between julus and qu'ud? They both mean sitting, but does anyone know the difference between the two? That's one difference. Good. Sah. Another difference? Yeah. Yes, sah. Julus is when you stand and you sit. When you're lying down and you sit, it's called qu'ud, right? So it's the position that you've come from. Are you there? So if you come from the standing to the sitting, so when somebody's standing, what do you say to them? Ijlis, that's right. If a person is lying, what do you say to them? Uqu'ud, right? So you don't tell a person who's standing, uqud. But both of them are sitting. And also qu'ud comes from the word remaining. It's when you sit somewhere for a while. So the mudda is also another difference between the two. The duration is also a difference. So the meaning here is the same though. The meaning is that what? They're both sitting. Are you with me, brothers? So this is called the type which is ma'nawi. The wording are not the same, but the meaning is the same. Okay? For example, the word, okay, what about wukuf and qiyam? What's the difference? Huh? Qiyam is when somebody's lying down. Qiyam, you say to somebody who's lying down to get up. And what about wukuf? You say to them, qif, that's one call. Hey, any other one? Huh? Qif is when somebody is in a movement stage. You say to them, stand. Hey, and what about qiyam? That call, by the way, is said, and Jahir says it in Kitab al-Haywana. Hey? Qiyam is when somebody's down, you go up. Hey, and also what you said before, duration as well, is still the same. Are you with me, brothers? Wukuf means you stood standing for a while, brother. Qiyam is not. No, Qiyam is, sorry, longer than wukuf. Wukuf is longer, shorter. Qiyam is longer. That's why it's called Qiyamul Layl. You should be standing for a while. Yeah? The Salah is called Qiyam, huh? It is Qiyam, but it goes against what the word really is. Allah accepted from us, but that's why it's called Qiyam, isn't it? It's meant, the whole point is that you stand for long. Huh? Wukuf, on the other hand, is what we do. We stand. You know? But we're meant to do Qiyam. Sah? The Prophet's legs used to swell. So, if you come to a masjid and the Imam does a page, you're like, A'udhu Billah, Mahanuddimah. You know, Fajr as well. Salahs that are meant to be long. Fajr is meant to be long. Maghrib is meant to be long. Isha is a bit, people want to go to sleep. The Prophet will shorten it slightly. Like in Maghrib, for example, the Prophet said, Athar have come that he prayed what? Surah Al-A'raf, all of it, he led it in Maghrib. Hatta kadir Isha yadkhul, until Isha was close to enter. Can you do that today? And how is the Prophet's qira'ah? Huh? I know a place in Egypt I used to go to, they lead Isha every night. They pray, they do one surah of the Quran until it reaches the half of Surah Al-Kahf. So one night, Isha, all of it will be, the first rak'ah will be all of Baqarah. In one stand, the first stand, all of the Baqarah will be prayed. بِالتَأَنِّي وَالتَّرَوِّي تَدَبُّرْ. He might repeat the ayah one or twice. Wallahi, you pray Isha right after it. The guy will stand up and do the Isha adhan. So when the person goes, and it's known, his masjid is well known for that. And then the second raka'ah, he will read half a juz. Half a juz in the second qiyam. So all the Baqarah, and half, because the first juz in Surah Ali Imran is كُلُّ طَعَمِ كَانَ حِلًّا صح. You read half. And then you're ready to go home, inshaAllah ta'ala. That's a prayer. That's a salah. Here, you pray two pages. Ooh. The people bring the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for you. Naam.
ظرف الزمان ظرف الزمان هو اسم الزمان المنصوب بتقدير العيد نحو اليوم والليلة وغدوة وبكرة وسحرا وغدا وعقمة وصباحا ومساء وأبدا وأمدا وحينا وما أشبه ذلك.
The author رحمه الله goes into something known as maf'ulu fihi. He goes into المفعول فيه. مفعول فيه is ظرف الزمان and ظرف المكان together. Both of them are called مفعول فيه. Are you with me, brothers? ظرف الزمان وظرف المكان, both of them are called مفعول فيه, which is also called ظرف. Okay? Some scholars just call it ظرف and some call it مفعول, مفعول فيه. ظرف الزمان is two types. It's مبهم and it's مختص. ظرف الزمكان is مبهم المختص لا يقبل النصب على الظرفية. It doesn't accept a نصب on the ظرفية. We'll speak about what that means. So how much types is the ظرف الزمان? It's two types, ambiguous and specific. مبهم المختص. The ظرف المكان is مبهم and it is also مختص. What does it mean, مبهم المختص? مبهم is what indicates an amount of time which is not specific. Like the word lahza, hina. The word hina and lahza, they all show lahza and hina, they all show duration, a duration. But it's not clear what it means. If somebody says to you, intadhirni lahza, there's really not a time they gave you. So if they come back 2 hours later, still a lahza, right? Are you there? It's not really a time that's restricted, fixed. Okay, it's subjective. So that's mubham. Okay, brothers? That's mubham. The second one is mukhtas. Okay, we're talking about zaman, it's mukhtas. How is it mukhtas? It's basically specific to a particular timing, like a day or a month or a year or something like that. And it is 12. The author mentioned them. It is 12. It's al-yawm, al-layla, ghudwa. So al-yawm means day. So it's from sunrise to sunset. من طلوع الفجر إلى غروب الشمس. If I say al-yawm, it means day. صمت اليوم, I fasted the day. واللَّيْلَة is غروب الشمس. غروب الشمس when the sun, layla is when the sun sets, إلى طلوع الفجر until the sun rises. So it's a restricted amount, it's مختص, specific. Are you with me, brothers? غدوة, on the other hand, is من صلاة الصبح إلى طلوع الشمس. Is غدوة, when Allah said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ تُبَوِّئُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَقَاعِدَ لِلْقِتَالِ. وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ, غَدَوْتَ, غَدَوْتَ. Of Somali is مركات كاللهيد, كاللهيدوة. Do you know what كاللهيد means? Dalma shuwa habinka. What dalma is night time. Night time ma makila dalma. Sah? When you go home and you're going from a long day, what dalma is when you go home at night time. But when you're leaving in the morning, it's called what? Asoka Allah. Have you heard that word before? Mama kasha kalma das. Yeah. Dialects are different, no? But it's kalahid, we all know, right? And that's what it means. وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ. So that shows that the Prophet ﷺ did it in the morning, alayhi salatu wasalam. He was preparing the army. So Allah says, وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ, the time you left in the morning, تُبَوِّئُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَقَاعِدًا لِلْقِتَالِ, and you were giving the believers their places. You were organizing them. You go this side, this is your part, you're going to be here, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's the barakah of doing things in the morning. Barakah. Energy, enthusiasm, your day still, you've got a long day, still you can do a lot of things. You leave here, you're so energized, you've learned, so the morning is the best. Then the word bukra. Bukra means what? Bukra actually means awwalun nahari min tulu' al-fajri. It's from the beginning of the day until sun sets. Are you with me? So when you say to a person bukra, it actually means that you, the day that you're speaking to them, it doesn't literally mean tomorrow. It actually just means from sunrise to basically sunset, I'll meet you. So in other words, you would always be saying that at the time when already the sun has rose. So it's always going to fall back the next day anyways. That's why it's said. The word saharan, the author brings, saharan is actually آخر الليل قبيل الفجر لكن. It's the last third of the night. Zah. when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, وَبِلْ أَسْحَارِهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ أَسْحَارِ. It means آخِرَ اللَّيْلِ قُبَيْلَ الْفَجْرِ. That's when they wake up, last third of the night. And they beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. Oh Allah, forgive us. غَدًا means then tomorrow. The word غَدًا means tomorrow. هُوَ الْيَوْمُ الَّذِي بَعْدَ يَوْمِكِ. The word tomorrow is actually غَدًا. Just tomorrow. عَتَمَةً. عَتَمَة is the first third of the night. It's ثُلُثُ الْأَوَّلِ اللَّيْلِ. It's the first third of the night. And the Prophet prohibited the believers using عَتَمَة for عِشَة. صح؟ The Prophet said, لَا يَغْلِبَنَّكُمْ. Do not let the Bedouins overcome you and change your prayer from Isha to Atama. Don't call it Atama. Don't let the Bedouins overcome you. Call it Isha. Atama. Atama means the first third of the night. Sabahan means it is أول نصف الليل الأخير إلى الزوال. It's basically the half of midnight until the zenith, which is dhuhr. All of that is called sabah. Masa is evening. Okay, which is 9. 10, 11 are abadan and amadan. And they basically mean it's al-mustaqbal, which is la nihayata laha, which has no, ama la nihayata lahu, that has no ending. It's when you say abadan, okay? If you say to somebody, la ukallimuka abadan, I will never speak to you, that's what it means, never ever, okay? The word amadan is also the same. The word hinan, we already spoke about it, and the word lahza, they are both mubham, right? Yeah, Sahar we said is the last third of the night, right? It's just before Fajr. Oh yeah.
Sabah we said
nisful layl. So Sabah we said it's nisful layl, the last, the half of the night until it goes to Dhuhr, it's called. Call it the Arabs. Now things have changed. Now people just call it morning. That's how they see it. Because no one will see you at the half of the night. حوكها قولي يا كسوبين على اختياس صح؟
وظرف المكان هو اسم المكان المنصوب بتقدير فيه مح أمام أو خلف وقدام ووراء وفوق وتحت وعند ومع وإزاء وحذاء وتلقاء وثم وهنا وما أشبه ذلك.
The author now goes into the second type of مفعول فيه, which is ظرف المكان. ظرف المكان is an ism that indicates a place, and the word fi is the summary of what it means. It's inside something. It's basically place. ظرف المكان is basically places, on top, bottom, right, left, front of you, behind you. Okay, all of those are used. It is. It's two types, as we said. There's darful makan, which is mubham, and it is those which don't have a, to be honest, it doesn't have a image you can have of it, which is restricted, narrowed down. No, it doesn't. An example for that is right, left, and front and back. They're not really restricted, because your front can be something very far, and it can be something very close. Okay? And it can be anything right in front of you. So anything here is in front of me. Okay? So, can it also enter front? Can it also emerge into what's on your right? It can. So if something's right over there, it's in front of me and it's also on my. So which one is it? So it's very hard to restrict it. Somebody might choose to say it's in front of me, but somebody might understand it's to be right in front of him. Another person might say it's on my right. And then you might think to somebody, when he says right, it's actually level to him. Are you with me? So they're mubham, they're really ambiguous. Are you there? Right and left and in front and behind them. They're not really. Are you with me? They're not really restricted. Whereas darfu makan, which is mukhtas, are you with me? It's actually restricted. It's very restricted. And it's like, for example, fi, inside. You're inside something, okay? دخلت في الدار, I entered the house, okay? You know that that person is inside the building, okay? وصليت في المسجد, I prayed inside the masjid. And the author, رحمه الله, brought 13 words. Okay, he brought 13 words. Amama, which is the opposite of behind. Are you there? It's just that the Quran, on the other hand, it uses some words which actually are the opposites of each other. Like, for example, the word wara, it means behind, but in the Quran, it's found to be in front. وَكَانَ وَرَاءَهُمْ مَلِكٌ يَأْخُذُ كُلَّ سَفِينَةٍ غَصْبًا. صح؟ وَكَانَ وَرَاءَهُمْ أي أمامهم. صح؟ So the word wara is what? In front, right? Here, right now, it means in the front. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Wara here means in front, but we know it's to be what? Behind. So there are some words in the Quran that are called tabad. Remember tabad? It means that the two opposites are present in this word. Sometimes that the word wara can be used as the front, and sometimes it can actually be used as the back. An example for that is also quru. قروء ثلاثة قروء قرئي أما قرئي. Are you with me? أما قرئي. Are you with me, brothers? What's the meaning? Some said it's طهر. Some said it is حيض. حيض is the opposite of طهر. Are you with me, brothers? So some words in the Quran that are opposite of each other. So again, the meaning comes out sometimes from a word based on the context. Are you there? But originally the word amam means in front, and wara is the opposite of khalf, which is behind. The second is khalf that the author brought, which is behind. And then he brought the word quddam. Quddam basically means in front as well. And wara, which is basically khalf as well. Fawqa, which is above, there's something high. Okay, tahta, which is something below. Inda, which is basically close to, next to. Are you with me? Ma'a. So it's a jurumiya to know the word inda. So when you're talking to a tyrant leader, the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, inda sultan al-jair. So you talk to him in front of him. That's what it is. The word inda in a jurumiya, you just learn it. It's qareeb. Next to him. Sah. And the Prophet said, speak in that language. So if you want to speak to him, say it in his face, where he sees you and he can hear you. That's the condition. Then the Prophet ﷺ said that that person is a what? That person is the greatest mujahid, right? Once he's done that, he goes to the leader, and if he sends him a letter, can that take the ruling? Yes, it can. Sending him a letter, it reaches him, it's idda. You made him read it. You made him know about it. So the word idda is used, so you take the meaning of the hadith. The word ma'a is with. Okay, it's when you unite with something, or do something, or you accompany something. Iza'a, it means muqabil, opposite. Hida'a means a close place. For example, you say, jalastu hida' al-abiri. I sat close to the prince. The word tilqa, it means the word iza', which is the opposite. So the word tilqa is actually the opposite. Thamma, okay, with a fatha on the tha, not thumma. Thamma is ismu ishara, and it's also used as a darfu makan, which is something far. Okay, huna is ismu ishara, and it's also used as a darfu makan, which is close. Huna here. Naam.
باب الحال هو الاسم المنصوب المصر المفسر لمن فهم
لمن؟
لمن بهم
لمن بهمها
لمن بهم من الهيئات نحو قولك جاء زيد راكبا وركبت الفرس مسرحا مسرجا ولقيت عبد الله راكبا وما أشبه ذلك ولا يكون الحال إلا نكرا ولا يكون إلا بعد تمام الكلام ولا يكون صاحبها إلا معرفة.
The author, rahimahullah, he goes into hal right now. And hal basically means ما عليه الإنسان من خير أو شر. Hal basically means the situation that you're in, whether it's good or bad. That's what it means, lughatan. According to the grammarian, on the other hand, it is الاسم المنصوب المفسر. So first condition is that the author here mentions five things. Five things is what brings about hal. The first one is ism. Okay. The second one is al-mansub. The third one is al-mufassir. Mufassir here means explainer, clarifier. A mubayyin, it clarifies. The fourth one is liman bahama. The word bahama, it means a khafiyah, that which is hidden. It clarifies that which is hidden. The word in bahama means a khafiyah, it is hidden. Min al-hayati. Hayat means forms. الصفات اللاحقة للذوات. It is characteristics that's connected to the individual. So basically, in summary, is basically you're going to explain the person's situation and their current state. So for example, you say جاء زيد راكبا. Zayd came in a state of ركوب. He was riding. He was mounted on a riding beast. So you're giving the people an understanding of the situation of this man when he came, Zayd. So the author brought it, the first example, which is Ja'a Zaydun, he brought it as a... Are you with me, brothers? Ja'a Zaydun Rakiban. The first one, he came to explain the what? To give the hal came in what? Brothers. The fa'il, right? Zaydun is talking about, so it's rakib al fa'il. The second one is wa rakibtu al farasa. Al farasa here is maf'ulun bih, right? And then musrajan is the maf'ulun bih. And then wa laqitu abdullahi, I met abdullahi rakiban. Okay? And the third example is not clear. Is it a fa'il or is it to a maf'ul bi? This is called ihtimal according to the grammarians. Laqitu Abdullah, ya Abdullah, rakiban. Is Abdullah the rakib? Or is he the rakib? Could be both. There's an ihtimal that it could be the fa'il himself or the maf'ul. The author brought those two, and there are three others that are missing from him that he hasn't mentioned. Where are we going to go? Where are we going to see that? Al-Mutammimatul Ajrumiyyah. The job of Mutammimatul Ajrumiyyah is what? To complete of things that Ajrumiyyah doesn't mention. Ayah? Then the author says, وَلَا يَكُونُ حَالُ إِلَّا نَكِرًا. The hal has to be nakira. It has to be indefinite. Okay? It has to be indefinite. فَلَا تَأْتِي مَعَرِفَةً. It doesn't come ma'arifa at all. It can't. If it comes, what's going to happen? Does anyone know? If the hal comes as a ma'rifa, what's going to happen? It's going to look like na'at. It's going to look like the na'at. صح? We took na'at. So the reason is, لِأَلَّا يُتَوَهَمْ. So there's no doubts that enters the student of knowledge, whether it is a hal or it's a na'at. So now we learn that. That's important that the author. وَلَا يَكُونُ. And the second condition that the author mentions, the first condition was أَن تَكُونَ نَكَرَةً. Okay, so it doesn't look like the na'at. And the second one is وَلَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا بَعْدَ تَمَامِ الْكَلَامِ. It has to come after the speech is finished. Okay, so when we say after the ending of the speech, it means that the مُبْتَدَى and the خَبَر have come. Or the fi'il and the fa'il have come. Are you with me? I mean, the sentence has to be a complete sentence that stand by itself. Then it can come. Okay? Number three is that, and don't worry about whether it can go before it or after it. Okay? That's not the condition here. Tamamul kalam doesn't mean it goes before or after. It just means the speech has to be complete. It has to be a complete sentence. Whether it goes before that or after, it doesn't matter. As long as the sentence is complete in its meaning. Okay, brothers? The third one is, وَلَا يَكُونُ صَاحِبُهَا إِلَّا مَعْرِفَةً. The thing in which it's giving you the situation of has to be ma'rifa. So, جَاءَ مُحَمَّدٌ ضَاحِكًا. Muhammad has to be known. Okay? Muhammad has to be... So you can't say, جَاءَ رَجُلٌ ضَاحِكًا. You can't. Hiya.
باب التمييز. التمييز هو الاسم المنصوب المصرف لمن فهم من الذوات نحو قوله تصبب زيد عرقا وتفقع بكر شهما وطاب محمد النساء واشتريت 20 غلاما وملكت 90 نعجة وزيد أكرم منك أبا وأجمل منك وجها ولا يكون إلا نكرة ولا يكون إلا بعد تمام الكلام